So let's break down how you would do this, how you would structure timing, okay? And maybe what you might want to break your fast with a little bit. I have other videos that break it down more, but let's take a look at the schedule here. There's something called a monk fast. Now, the name might be a little bit misleading because you may not be doing it for the specific monk purposes, but the benefits of a monk fast, which is a 36-hour, one-time-per-week fast, are pretty darn amazing. So I'll give you a very, very, very brief history lesson, but I'm not a history expert, so I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on that. I want to focus on, hey, this is something that you can do once per week and get some huge benefit, and a very specific kind of benefit if it's what you're after. Okay, so a monk fast is a 36-hour, one-time-per-week fast that is done by a specific kind of monk that follows the monastic code of what is called the Vinaya. Okay, the purpose of a monk fast isn't for them to lose weight or anything like that. It was designed to help them get a clearer mind and become closer to the earth and closer to one another and closer to themselves. Okay, because you get a big boost of cognitive function that comes in after like 16, 20 hours of a fast. So we'll talk about that. And that'll help you understand if this is a pattern of fasting that you want to experiment with. So we'll cover what exactly it is, how you should go about doing it, what the benefits are, and what some of the things you can expect are. And then towards the end of this video, I'll lay out a sample schedule for you so you have a little bit more of an idea. Feel free to skip ahead to that part, but I do recommend you get the education prior to that. Please do hit that red subscribe button and then hit that little bell icon. That way you can turn on notifications and you never ever miss a beat when we post our daily videos. The length of a fast is very important. You see, after about 16 hours, your body starts to shift into a different energy creating mode. There's a study that was published in the Annual Review of Nutrition that showed that during a fast, after hour 16, the body starts to utilize more energy from what is called gluconeogenesis. So essentially, after 16 hours, the body runs out of stored carbohydrates and it starts to use glucose that is created from other substrates, literally created from fat breakdown, literally created from some forms of protein, and literally created from lactate, which is a byproduct of exercise. So at 16 hours, all of a sudden, the body needs glucose. But in order to use that glucose, it has to create it from something else, like fat. You can see how at 16 hours, that means that we have a big improvement in our potential fat loss. So this 36-hour, one-time-per-week fast thing might work really well for those that just, I don't know, don't want to fast frequently, but just want to do it one time and get it out of the way. The other thing that's interesting with this study is a study found that between 15 and 20 hours, you could have as much as a doubling of your ketone levels. So at 15 hours, hypothetically, if your ketones are 0.5 or at 1, at 20 hours, they might be at 1 or at 2. So between 15 and 20 hours, your potential ketone levels double. Okay, that means you're getting a huge benefit from the ketones. Now, let me kind of put this into perspective how this works. Okay, normally we think about ketones versus glucose. Ketones have a bunch of benefits, and yeah, I talk about that all the time, but glucose has its benefits too. What we really want is the best of both worlds. We want our body to utilize glucose a little bit, but we also want ketones in the equation because they have a lot of different, well, potentially healing properties and different genetic processes that really affect us in a positive way. It turns out that the brain continues to use glucose pretty aggressively up until about 28 hours. So let me put this into context a little bit. At 16 hours, your body starts making glucose. It doesn't have it in the storage form anymore, so it starts making it. Well, all the way up until 28 hours, your brain is demanding glucose, which means the demand to make glucose is very high. That means that the demand to turn fat into glucose is very high. So in essence, between 16 and 28 hours, you have a really good sweet spot where your body is utilizing glucose and ketones, and you're getting potentially a maximum fat burning effect. Now, because you have ketones and glucose in the equation at the same time, you're getting really a lot of benefit. And remember that normally, when glucose is being burned or utilized by the brain, you have a large amount of what is called oxidative stress, okay? Oxidative damage. It's just a result of using glucose. Well, because ketones are also present during this time, it helps clean basically the oxidative stress because ketones serve as an antioxidant. Okay, they serve as something that helps modulate inflammation, but they also serve as something that burns as a cleaner fuel. So even though you're burning a dirtier fuel with glucose, you have ketones present to help mitigate that a little bit. Now, when we talk about the brain, this is where it gets really interesting. During a fast, you have an increase in synaptic activity within the brain. Okay, think about it like this. You're fasting. Well, from an evolutionary standpoint, if you aren't eating, your body is going to preserve energy for the brain because it is our best mechanism of survival to use our brain. So energy goes to the brain. So we have an increase in that overall energy in the brain. Well, that improves what is called the differentiation of nerve cells. Basically, it makes it so that neuronal stem cells turn into neurons. So we have more brain energy. So potentially you're getting more solidification of your cognitive ability. And additionally, ketones elevate what is called BDNF. Okay, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. What that does is that helps the brain combat stress and it helps neurons grow as well. So you have this big increase in cognitive function that comes during a fast. So pretty cool stuff. Now let's get down to the granular stuff with a 36-hour fast specifically though. There was a study that was published in the journal Cell Metabolism. Took a look at alternate day fasting. Okay, here's the thing. This study did look at 36-hour fasts, but it looked at them in an alternate day fashion, not necessarily typical monk fast fashion where you would do it one time per week, but it still kind of gets the point across in terms of body composition. Okay, so what it did is it took two groups. One group did alternate day fasting where they fasted for 36 hours and then they ate whatever they want, unlimited amounts, for 12 hours the next day. Okay, then they went back to a fast. And they compared this to another group that they said, hey, go ahead and just eat ad libitum, eat whatever you want, as much as you want, no real, you know, issues, but don't try to gain weight, don't try to lose weight. Well, they found that the group that did the alternate day fasting lost 7.7 pounds, and they didn't really overeat all that much on their eating days, probably because their stomach shrank. But the most impressive thing is even when they were not fasting, they had elevated levels of ketones, even on their eating days, that carried over to the next day. Meaning this 36-hour fast has a benefit that carries over for multiple days, maybe one, two, three, who knows, it depends on the person. So you get all the benefits of the ketones that are coming during a fast. Because the fast is long enough, it carries over into the next day, even when you're eating. Now, the reason that I like monk fast so much is because it allows you to get it out of the way. You're doing a 36-hour longer fast the beginning of the week, and then you just can go out throughout your day as usual. You're basically doing a long fast in lieu of, well, multiple shorter fasts. So if you do a monk fast where you do 36 hours, you're getting that extra benefit because you're getting that extra time period where your body can utilize fat as a fuel source, where it can utilize gluconeogenesis, where it can upregulate all these different enzymatic processes. So let's break down how you would do this, how you would structure timing, okay? And maybe what you might want to break your fast with a little bit. I have other videos that break it down more, but let's take a look at the schedule here. This is what I would do. I would eat dinner, okay, maybe 5, 6 p.m., something like that, right? Eat dinner, then stop calorie consumption altogether after dinner. Okay, you'll go to bed that night, you'll wake up the next morning, and you'll only drink water. Work out, do whatever you want to do, try to live your life as normal. Okay, try to allocate your tasks that require a lot of cognitive function a little bit later in the day when you're deeper into that fasted state where you might get that larger benefit. But you're not going to eat that entire day, and you're not going to eat for dinner either. Okay, then you're going to go to bed, and you're gonna wake up the next morning and you will be at roughly 36 hours. Okay, you are gonna be at a point where you're very insulin sensitive. So whatever you eat at that point in time, your body will just grab onto. What I would highly recommend is prior to breaking your fast, get a little workout in. This is the ideal situation for someone that wants to stay lean, but maybe put on a little bit of muscle or build some muscle tone. Okay, the reason is you have a nice ketone buffer that's gonna help make it so that you don't break down muscle as much. But you're also going to be so insulin sensitive that when you break your fast, you'll be able to consume protein that'll hopefully get shuttled into the muscle cell a little bit better. So if you're trying to build muscle, you're so insulin sensitive, it works out great. I usually recommend after this length of a fast that you break your fast with a little bit of bone broth first because the gelatin is what is called a hydrophilic colloid, which brings the water to the gelatin. So not only can it help the digestion a little bit, but it can also help that gut mucosal layer that breaks down with longer fasts. I did go ahead and I linked out to Kettle and Fire down below in the description. They're a big supporter of this channel, but they're also my go-to bone broth whenever I'm breaking a longer term fast. So you want to do this to at least provide a layer of security for your gut that does tend to break down a little bit during a fast. So special link if you want to check them out down below in the description. You can use them for breaking any length fast, but I highly, highly, highly recommend them. Again, special link down below after you watch this video. So then after you have something like your bone broth, then you'd want to go ahead and have some lean protein. Okay, now the idea behind having the lean protein is it's not going to trigger a massive insulin spike. It's going to get you what's called thiamine, which you need after a longer term fast. Talk about that in other videos. But it's also going to satiate you so you don't go and just binge on a bunch of food like would be very, very easy to do at the end of a fast. Okay, so eat maybe 4 to 8 ounces of protein after you break this longer fast. And then 2 to 3 hours later, go ahead and eat a larger meal. Now, here's a very important point that I highly recommend you do. Okay, so the monk fast, if you look at it historically, they're all about eating during the morning hours and not really eating in the afternoon or evening hours during this particular instance. So what I would recommend is, if you really want to keep it true and get an awesome benefit, is break your fast, as I discussed, eat until about 12 or 1 p.m., and then fast again until the next day, which is only going to be like a 16-hour fast. But basically what you're doing is almost doing a back-to-back fast, except one is a 36-hour fast, and then you're eating for 12 hours, and then you're going into like a shorter 14, 16-hour fast. And it's not to try to do another fast. It's to give your digestive system a little bit of a break. Because you're breaking your fast in the morning, you don't want to be loading yourself up with a full day of eating. That's a lot of food. So breaking your fast in the morning is a perfect period to just eat during that morning period and then give the afternoon off, go into another fast. Plus, this is an added benefit, your ketone levels are still elevated. So you're going to get into that fasted state much faster and you're almost extending the benefits of your 36-hour fast. You don't have to be as particular when you break the second fast, but either way, you can still use the bone broth, you can still do whatever you need to do there. So what you typically want to do is do this like once per week. I would recommend whenever I do monk fasting, this is how I do it, going like fast on a Monday, okay? And then that way you're like stopping your eating Sunday night, fasting all day Monday, and breaking your fast Tuesday morning, and then you're good to go. This is just one kind of fasting that you can do that works very, very well. Anyhow, if you want to hear more about the different kinds of fasting that are out there, whether you are just curious or you want to try different things, make sure you comment down below and let me know, because there are a plethora of different fasting modalities that work very, very well. Anyhow, as always, keep it locked in here on my channel, and I'll see you tomorrow.